hello. It's hard to tell. It's hard to know if everybody can see me and hear me, and I hope you all can. Welcome to WTTW and America's Test Kitchen's virtual event, Six Secrets to Stress-Free Holiday Meals. My name is Brandis Friedman. I'm the co-anchor of Chicago Tonight, WTTW's news and public affairs program, weeknights at 7 p.m. I'm also the host of Chicago Tonight Black Voices. It airs on Sunday evenings at 6 p.m. So clearly, I spend a lot of time following the news, but like you, I'm also a foodie. I spend a lot of time thinking about food. I spend a lot of time eating food. So I'm really excited to be hosting this exciting event. It's going to be great. Just wait. Before we get started, I want to recognize one of our generous sponsors. Our thanks to Sue and Bob Wiesenek for all of your wonderful support of the cooking programming on WTTW. And of course, we have to thank you, all of our members. What we do at WTTW wouldn't be possible without your ongoing financial support. So we're very grateful. Thank you very much. So we're a few moments away from welcoming our special guests, Julia Collin Davison and Jack Bishop. But first, I have a few housekeeping details I want to share. So you know, you probably guessed everyone is attending this webinar in listen-only mode, but that doesn't mean you can't communicate with us. I encourage you to use the chat function to engage with other audience members and to send me questions that I will be asking Jack and Julia throughout the presentation and later on during our Q&A session as well. In my experience, I find that sometimes the attendees have better questions than I do, so send them on. That chat function can be found at the bottom right of your screen. Some of you have already submitted questions and we'll be asking those as well. We got a lot of questions. I will try and get to them all, I promise. You can also adjust what's on your screen by clicking the screen view that's in the upper right-hand corner and choosing what is best for your viewing enjoyment. I think a lot of us have gotten lots of experience with how to work these things over the last few months. And of course, if you want to watch this event again, or if you want to share it with others, maybe whoever's doing the cooking in your house, maybe you are, you think they should see this, it is being recorded and relevant links will be posted on WTTW's digital channels as well. And for those of you who are really good at the multitasking want to be posting this to your social media channels during and after this event, please use the hashtag HolidayTipsWTTW. And that hashtag HolidayTipsWTTW is going to be important later on because you'll have an opportunity to win a WTTW Cook's Apron autographed by Julia or Jack, plus an America's Test Kitchen 20th Anniversary Cookbook and the complete Cook's Country Season 13 TV show cookbook. We also have other ways to win, more on all of that soon. So now let's get on to the main event. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the beloved hosts of America's Test Kitchen, Julia Collin Davison and Jack Bishop. I feel like there should be applause when you guys arrive. I'll do it.
Hello, so nice to see you, Brandis.
You as well, welcome.
Thank you.
Hey everybody, I miss Chicago.
We miss you.
I mean, all the places we get to travel, I know I'm always going to have a good dinner in Chicago. So, you know, looking forward to getting back and seeing you guys next year in person.
Likewise.
Ditto. So excited to tell you a bit more about this season of America's Test Kitchen for us. We just wrapped up filming of it in September. We filmed all summer long, which is very unusual for us. Usually when we film a season of America's Test Kitchen, that's 26 episodes. And we film it in about 3 weeks, 3.5 weeks. We do all the recipes, then we do Jack segments and Adam segments. And then it goes into the editing room and it gets cut up and put together into shows over the summer. But this year, because of everything going on, we couldn't all be in the same space and filming. So we all filmed from our own homes. So all the test cooks are gonna be cooking recipes in their own kitchens, which is really fun. Instead of a 5-camera shoot, it was a 3-camera shoot, a little more intimate. And we just figured we wanted to develop new TV shows and how best to do it. And actually, from my point of view, it was a blast. Not only because it's fun to do something new in your own home, but also I think it gave a different perspective on the food. Whereas very often we're in the test kitchen, it's very formal. It's very scientific, you know, it's very pristine. And in my own kitchen, you know, there was a dog running around and it was very homey, but you got to see the same recipes, but in a just a slightly different atmosphere. And I think it just made them a little more realizable as a home cook, that you could really see how you could do this in your home kitchen. And also, we went back to some basics, how to chop an onion, how to sear a steak, how to braise meat, because I think a lot of people are getting back into cooking and wanting to remind themselves what the basics are. So we did some really, we did some science, as we always do, because the science of good food is really at the heart of America's Test Kitchen and Cooks Illustrated magazine. But we went to back to the basics. And Jack was actually in his own home. Now, we didn't make him taste his taste products by himself and try to fool himself. That would have been a little silly. But Jack, you you came up with a new way to do your segments, which I thought was really neat.
Yeah, I mean, they sort of morphed from taste tests, where I'm usually trying to stump Julia or stump Bridget, to basically shopping advice. Basically, the segments are what I would tell my sister when she calls me four times a week asking for advice about what she should be buying at the supermarket, or how to read a label, or you know, what's actually important when you're buying a bottle of extra virgin olive oil, and less so much about tasting one brand versus another, because obviously by myself, doing a blind taste test doesn't really work if you're by yourself. So we had a lot of fun. We did a lot of unique segments, what we called at-home segments. So my favorite was I gave a tour of my freezer. So I know everybody out there in Chicago wants to know what's in Jack Bishop's freezer. And the interesting
we
part-
sure do.
We do. And there are all kinds of interesting things that are in my freezer that I feel like people don't put in their freezer that keep much better in your freezer. Like butter, for instance, doesn't belong in the fridge. It belongs in the freezer.
I know you can hear me, but you could just say mind blown, but it doesn't really work as well.
It picks up all kinds of off odors in your fridge. And so when I buy several pounds of butter, which I usually do at a time, they all go in the freezer. And then I take one stick at a time and put it in the fridge as I need it and keep the rest of it fresh in the freezer for months. So anyway, we had a lot of fun filming the show. And, you know, we have even something to show you guys, you know, hasn't really been seen anywhere.
That's right.
It is the first public debuting anywhere in the country of the, what we call the sizzle reel, the highlight reel from season 21.
Welcome to America's Test Kitchen at home.
At home.
At home.
At home.
At home.
At home. An Olympian worthy pastizia. It's a lot easier than exercising.
Ta-da!
That is a taco. So what I have here is some cornstarch. It's just in a pie plate. You can use any sort of plate. We're gonna hit both sides of the salmon, and then you wanna brush off any extra with a pastry brush. You wanna make sure you get it all over your shirt. That's how everyone can know that you've been the one in the kitchen.
Now, I like to store our parsley in a little jug of water because it reminds me, A, that my husband never sends me flowers, and this will have to do. But also, it's just going to keep the herbs nice and lively.
This is my absolute favorite knife. I got this in France, and it's a carbon steel knife. You'll have so much more fun in the kitchen if you have knives that fit you. So, just a little tip.
Today, I want to talk about my tank. It's a very good tank. I filled with 20 pounds of CO2 and I use it to carbonate everything I can get my hands on. And I want to show you why you should do the same thing.
I grew up having Maggi seasoning. It's kind of what you get if Worcestershire sauce and soy sauce got together and had a baby, and that baby was supercharged with umami.
I'm just going to put this in our food processor and buzz it for 5 to 7 pulses until it's coarsely chopped. I'm going to plug it in too, that's always good.
I guess this is my day for tiny little tools. My little tiny measuring cup and my little tiny whisk that I absolutely love.
This smells so amazing. Fresh corn, red peppers, onion, garlic, and cayenne, and butter beans, my favorite.
And finally, your favorite Hawthorn strainer by Cocktail Kingdom. This helps you hold back ice or ingredients like fresh mint or lemon after you mix drinks.
With each of these tools, you're ready to drain anything. Here's mud in your eye.
Mom, if you're watching TV, I want you to turn off the set right now. Okay, good. Her mother's not here, so I can tell you, I hated tuna fish when I was a kid, and I had it all the time.
Fresh green salad, how do I love thee? All that ingredient prep, do I love thee? With the right salad gear, which we have here, it could well be. Okay, so I'm not a poet.
Oh, this pineapple has beautiful grill marks on both sides, but it's still holding together. We haven't overcooked it. It's gonna add a really lovely, slightly grilled flavor to the salsa.
So to go with my very special waffles, I have a very special guest for brunch today. My mom, Dr. Price.
Hi.
Hi. I made waffles.
I'm excited. You know, I love waffles.
I got some toppings here, Mom. I got peaches. I have maple syrup.
I want everything. Heavy on the goodness.
All right.
It's cheese time. It's always a good time when it's cheese time. You know that you're nearing the end of the pizza making extravaganza when the cheese hits the board.
The tatka is just about done and the color is beautiful. Oh, this is like magic happening in the kitchen right now. Delicious.
So it's time to flip. Now, if I were brave, I would do it in one fell swoop. But I'm not. I'm going to do it the safe way.
Seo in Banseo means sizzling, and that means we need a really hot skillet. Got a full half cup, and then in we go. So you can see it's already got lots of little bubbles in the top, like when you make pancakes, they're popping through. That's going to give us some of that nice lacy texture.
Okay, so our second batch of cookies has come out of the oven, and they've cooled, and they're ready to eat, and I brought in a special person.
Aww.
My mom. You want to help yourself?
These are delicious.
From America's Test Kitchen at Home, a great recipe for chili verde con cerdo. It's really good.
Okay, so for anybody who missed that, January 21st, wait, January. Just mark your calendar for January, people. It's happening. You're gonna wanna be there for it. So Julia, I think you've got a recipe for us. I think we're gonna get started on. Julia's gonna tell us about the recipe in a minute, obviously, but I want you all to know you will have access to it. We'll be sharing it. I think both either online and or socially, and of course you'll receive it via email. So Julia, what you cooking?
Yeah, well, today I wanted to show you, I think, a recipe that will be very useful for a lot of us this Thanksgiving. I imagine many Thanksgiving tables will be a little smaller this year, and I know we'll all probably be a little bit more thankful and deeply grateful for what has gone right for us this year and any of our good fortune. And so today I'm going to make a roasted turkey breast that you roast on top of a pan of stuffing. So usually when you stuff a turkey, not something we love to recommend, although we do have some recipes for it if you're dead set on it, but because it's kind of hard and the stuffing doesn't roast at the same rate as the bird. But if you roast a turkey breast on top of the pan of stuffing, you get that mix of flavors. And also a turkey breast, pretty inexpensive. I've been finding them for about $17, $18, and they roast pretty quickly and they serve a small crowd. So that's what I'm going to show you how to make today. But along the way, feel free to ask me questions and I'm going to show some basics. I see one question already in the chat, which I'm going to answer, which is what does a sprig of herbs look like? How big is a sprig? All right, I pulled out three sprigs. This one's wimpy. Let's see. That's a wimpy sprig. This is a really big sprig. But for me, I'd say this is the perfect sprig. It's, I'd say, about 4 inches long. It's got a bunch of nice leaves. So thereabouts. It's by no means is a sprig a very super accurate measurement of herbs. But for most sprigs, you're just throwing it in a pot and plucking it out later. So you can kind of judge it from there. All right, so to get started, I'm going to show you how to chop an onion, which is the most requested demo I get. I'm going to angle my camera down so you can see my cutting board. Now, first thing I want to point out is you got to have a sharp knife. And I think the problem that most people have at home is their knives aren't sharp. So I'm going to show one of my all-time favorite kitchen tools. This is the Chef's Choice Knife Sharpener. Buy it once, buy it right, and you'll have sharp knives forever. Sharpening a knife from totally dull back to a nice sharp knife only takes about 3 minutes using this machine. It's a great gift. And if you keep your knife sharp, it's more fun to cook for sure. And the food turns out better because it's a more precise cut.
I was going to ask you about the knife sharpener. My husband, don't tell him I told you this, he sends his off to be sharpened, which just seems like a pain, right? Because then we don't have knives for a few days.
It's smart because they can get them super sharp. I used to send mine out, but I have to say this little gadget works just as well. And I know how to use a honing stone. I have a few in the basement, but I still pull this out because it's easier. And my daughter's 12 and I taught her how to use it yesterday. So it's a good chore for the kids.
All right, thank you. Sorry. Please continue with the onion chopping.
Yeah, no. So here's a little onion. And so, you know, it has a root end and this tip end, and you just want to cut the tip end off. And what I'm going to do is cut the onion in half through the root end. And it's that root end that holds the layers together as you dice. And so now's when I peel the onion. And then I'm going to show you a new way to cut an onion that I think makes it really easy for people if you're wanting to work on your knife skills or you're a bit more of a beginner, which is cut it into a quarter again through that root end. So the root end's holding the layers together. And watch, it eliminates one of the trickier cuts when cutting an onion. So we're going to cut down towards the root, but not through it. And then you kind of tip it on the other side and do that again. So, and then you can just slice through and make a dice. I'm going to show that one more time because I know
while you're doing it a second time, Julia, one of the questions that we've got in the chat is, when a recipe says one large or one medium onion, what's the actual measurement for each? So like, what's the yield?
One medium onion is one cup chopped. And we only pretty much call for medium onions. The other thing about onions, I don't know if anyone cries when they chop an onion, especially if you wear glasses. Yeah, Jack. I wear contacts, which actually helps. So my mother hates chopping onions. My father doesn't seem to bother him at all. And he'll have an onion cutting day. He'll cut up a ton of onions and he'll measure out a cup and put it in a freezer bag and put them in the freezer. And then you can cook them right from the freezer. You can put the pan oil in the pan, turn it on, dump the frozen onion out of the bag into the pan, and you're off to the races, which is one of my favorite tricks for weekday cooking. Because sometimes just getting over that initial hurdle of chopping the onion and you're off and sauteing, and then it's a lot easier. So that's one of my favorite onion prep tips. All right, so here I'm gonna show you this again. Here's a quarter of an onion. I'm gonna slice down to the root end, but not through. Tip it on the other side. Do that again. Any pieces that fall off, it's okay. Just put them around to the back for later. And then you can just mince down through the onion. And then when I get down to this onion core, I really get as close as I possibly can. We used to get graded in culinary school on how big these trim pieces were. So I've gotten in the hang of leaving nothing behind. And then again, I put those bigger pieces to the side. And now's when you can pull them forward and chop them until it's a nice fine dice. All right, so this recipe, we're going to start on the stovetop, and I actually have a stovetop camera so you can see what I'm doing. So I started by sauteing these onions for about 10 minutes to get them nice and soft. And you notice I'm using a roasting pan, and you can just put that roasting pan right on the burner.
And are you sauteing these in olive oil?
Yes. Eagle eye over there. Yes, it's about half a cup of olive oil. But I actually sprayed the pan also with some nonstick spray because, again, we're going to build the stuffing in here and you want it to come out of the pan at the end. So that's 3 cups of onions or 3 onions, and they've been sauteing for about 10 minutes. And now I'm going to add some garlic, 6 cloves of garlic and a little salt. And the garlic just needs a couple of seconds, really, to bloom and to when you can smell it. Again, 10 to 30 seconds, depending on how hot your pan is all it takes. And now I'm gonna turn the heat off. Now, classic stuffing has 2 herbs, sage and thyme, and I have both of them here. A tablespoon of fresh thyme and 2 tablespoons of fresh sage. Oh, it's starting to smell like stuffing. Now I'm gonna add a third cup of
white. Jack, can you smell it? Smells like stuffing.
I read an article the other day that said smell-o-vision is on the way.
Awesome.
Looking into it, I know. So that was a third of a
Especially
cup of white wine.
Work.
I know. Or if you don't have white wine, you could use vermouth, which I often like for cooking because it has a lovely rounded floral flavor and it's shelf stable. So you can keep it all in your pantry all year round. Now I'm gonna add 3 cups of chicken broth. And now's time for the bread. Now, when choosing a bread for this, usually when you make stuffing, you want to dry the bread ahead of time to stale it before making it. But you don't have to do that with this recipe because the stuffing's going to be open in the air of the oven for the entire cooking time. So you can just cut it up, and we're going to use ciabatta because it has a nice crush to interior ratio and the crust isn't super hard, not like a baguette. So this is 2 loaves of ciabatta, which is about 2 pounds of bread.
So, and if you can't find, and Julia, if you can't find ciabatta, is there something you recommend in its place?
Yeah, a supermarket Italian loaf would be just fine. But and the poundage is really what you want to think about. Again, that was 2 pounds of bread, because depending on how dense or light the bread is, the poundage will help you out there. So now we're just going to toss this together. And this is where you can have some fun and have some variations. I really like sausage in my stuffing. So I'm going to take some Italian sausage, and you can use spicy or mild. You could use a sage stuffing, or sausage rather. And if you didn't want to do sausage, but you wanted to add some sauteed mushrooms or some sauteed fennel, you could have done that too. I'm just breaking the sausage up into pieces, and I'm going to stir it into all the bread. And last but not least, I'm going to put the turkey breast right on top. Now, this is a 5 to 7 pound bone-in turkey breast. And I said, as I said earlier, they're pretty inexpensive and widely available. And it's great because it serves just a small army. And what I've done to this turkey ahead of time, and you don't have to do this, but I find it really makes the skin pretty crisp, is you salt and pepper it and put a little thyme on it, and you leave it uncovered like this in the refrigerator. And so the air drying just tightens up the skin and dries it a bit so that it gets nice and crisp in the oven. And so now I'm just gonna put this right on top of the stuffing, and into the oven it goes for about 2 to 2.5 hours at 325. You should rotate it halfway through cooking because most ovens aren't calibrated super evenly, that the center of the oven can be up to 50 degrees different than the edges, which is why when you bake tray cookies, if one end is a little more done than the other, it's the oven. So rotating it halfway through will make sure you have even browning. And there's a magic number here. There's a magic number that everyone needs to know. It's the temperature at which white meat, if it's poultry, is done. And this works for turkey and chicken. And actually, that's one of the biggest questions we get, is how to know when things are done. And, you know, having a thermometer like this, this is our winning thermometer. It's a ThermoPen. It's on the expensive side. It's about $100. But I've melted these by the grill. I've left them too close to the stove and it still works. So I can vouch for its durability. And it reads temperatures very quickly. And this will absolutely make you a better cook. And the combination of this and knowing your temperatures. So the magic temperature for white meat, for turkey and chicken, is 160 to 165. You want to aim for that range. And if you just know some basic numbers, white meat is 160 to 165. And for everyone listening, you might want to remember that just in case you need this information later on in this program, 160 to 165 for white meat.
Or when you're making the turkey.
Or when you're making the turkey. It's in all of our recipes, actually. Every recipe for meat and even salmon have temperatures. So, all right, 160 to 165. This turkey is going to go in the oven. And then Jack has some really interesting information about looking through this year and what has resonated with our readers. And then I'll come back and show you the finished dish.
Yeah. And I think before Jack does that, we have some prizes. I feel like there should be like confetti and balloons and Zoom really should work on that. Okay.
Just Emmys raining from your ceiling.
That's what it is. You get one and you get one. Okay. So giveaway, right? We've got one winner for this first one. There will be other opportunities. The first person who answers this question correctly in the chat, and then we'll tell you who wins after Jack is going to have a presentation in a minute. We'll tell you who wins. So the question is, ladies and gentlemen, to what temperature, or I'll phrase it more simply, what temperature should you cook turkey to? And remember, while we're at it, the hashtag holiday tips WTTW. That's hashtag holiday tips WTTW. I can see the chat filling up now. If you want to know what you win, boys and girls, we have a WTTW cook's apron. I think I'm doing a really good job holding it up. So, and this one, lucky you, is signed by the Jack Bishop right here, as well as an America's Test Kitchen 20th anniversary cookbook. I really should have gotten my nails done for presentation. Okay, so I will tell you who wins in a little bit, but Jack, you've got a bit more on the evolution of ATK over the years, especially lately.
Yeah, I love watching Julia chop an onion. It's like one of my favorite things to like watch Julia cook. And I
can't watch the ballet.
that, you know, she's going to cook a whole turkey in what, 10 minutes, you know, through the magic of television. But while the turkey is in the oven, I thought I would share with you a little view of like what our year has been like, because it's been challenging and rewarding. It seems like everyone is cooking. I know that Julia's seeing this and I'm seeing this. Everybody that in our entire lives is like, who never cooked is now suddenly cooking and calling us all the time for advice. And so I pulled a bunch of social media data. This is the most popular post by month starting in March. And I thought it told you kind of the whole story of the pandemic as it impacts what we've been doing in America's Test Kitchen. So why don't we cue the first slide, calling this the year in numbers, and let's start with March. And so the first post here, and don't worry, I know you can't read all this. I'm gonna sort of talk you through all of this. This post on the left is actually our colleague, Lisa McManus. And this is the most popular Facebook post America's Test Kitchen has ever done. Over 2.4 million views in 2 days. Lisa has two college-age sons, and one of them goes to college in Boston right around the corner from where she lives. And he had a friend who got stranded at the beginning of the pandemic who could not get back home to Asia. And suddenly Lisa went from being an empty nester to having three college kids, her two children and her adopted son. He actually lived there until college started again in September. So she had an extra son for 6 months. And she made a video of what it was like now being home rather than working in the test kitchen. And basically anybody who knows anything about 20 something boys is you're cooking all day in order to just keep them fed. The other two posts on this page, free recipes, chocolate chip cookies, and substitutions. I feel like March was all about, I don't have flour, I don't have eggs, I don't have toilet paper, we didn't have a substitution for that. Now, what should I do? Let's take a look at April, which is the next slide. April we began, the most popular post was choose your quarantine house. So what are the recipes that you are making and how does that define who you are? The second post in the middle there is about how to stretch ground meat with a depression era recipe that uses onions to get more burgers from a small amount of ground beef. And I think that kind of summed up April. And then the last and the third most popular post of the month was actually in my home. These are my two daughters making a video of basically working for me. They were taking photographs and videos, and in their down moments, everyone in my house was knitting, which that seems to be the story of, at least in my world, of April. And I think our fans love to sort of see us shooting photography and making videos and a sort of real world view of what was going on in my home with my wife and our two adult children. So come May, it has been, in addition to the pandemic, Black Lives Matter and the cultural reckoning that especially in the food business has been a really important and meaningful conversation. And that was the number one post in the month of May. We were nominated for a Daytime Emmy. So Julia and Bridget, congratulations to the team. We're gonna win the best show award. And we're gonna be back in Los Angeles next year collecting that statue. And then the third most popular post is every Mother's Day. This is our most favorite recipe from America's Test Kitchen. It's a lemon layer cake, and some things don't change. And same thing, this year for Mother's Day, people wanted lemon layer cake, and it is an absolutely delicious recipe. So if we look at June, again, and, the top post of the month was again about Black Lives Matter and our specific responses and new initiatives that we announced at the company. Second most popular post was a milkshake. And if you read this, it's boozy ultimate chocolate milkshakes, which I think kind of sums up the year is you want a milkshake, but you want something extra. And then cheese is the third most popular, cheddar cheese coins. Anything with cheese always is popular on Facebook. July, so this is chocolate, and gear. That thermometer that Julia was talking to you about was the third most popular post. Our fans love our gear, love our reviews. Lisa McManus and the rest of the reviews team is trusted because nobody does what they do, which is buy all that equipment that we pay for and then test it to the ultimate degree. August, coffee cake, more gear with air fryers and margaritas. Yes, there's a theme here, boozy milkshakes and margaritas. And finally, the month of September, and slow cooker, chocolate, and chocolate. So that's a little snapshot into what our fans have been reacting to from the March through September. But the holidays coming up, I thought I would share with you a lot of research we do. We have a two-person research team that is doing surveys every day about what happened last Thanksgiving. Your guess is as good as mine as to what Thanksgiving is going to look like, but let me share with you some data about what you all did last Thanksgiving and as we begin to plan. I love this slide. This shows you how many dishes you made, and I just thought you guys would like to know, I'm an overachiever. Last year we made 16 different dishes. We had 18 people at my house. We're not going to have 18 people here this year. And a list of all the different things that we made. You can see the sweet spot. Most people make 7 to 9 dishes. My guess is it will be fewer dishes this year for Thanksgiving. Next slide is about the mains. No big surprise here. 97% of people make turkey. Surprised that there's so many hams and vegetarian entrees. And I love dinner rolls. I'm actually in the 17% of people who do not serve dinner rolls. There's so many other starches on the table. We have stuffing, we have mashed potatoes, we have noodle kugel, we have so many delicious starches. We don't do rolls in my house for Thanksgiving. Next up is all about the sides. We do sweet potatoes in my house, and we do potatoes, and we do green beans, and we do salad, and we do Brussels sprouts. We don't usually do corn, carrots, squash, broccoli, or peas. By the way, this photograph in the top right is the mashed potato casserole, which is a make-ahead recipe from Cook's Country. That's absolutely my favorite Thanksgiving dish, and I will be making that again this year. And then, of course, we have to end the meal by talking about pies. You all love pumpkin pie. You know, we're an apple and pecan pie family here. We make both, but America loves pumpkin pie when it comes to Thanksgiving. A large number of people either bake them or have somebody else bake them. And then last but not least, we actually have data by state. And so apple pie is favorite in 36 states, including Illinois. Anybody in Wisconsin or Indiana, you too fall into the apple category. I love that lemon meringue is popular out west. No surprise, pecan pie is popular down south. No idea about the Kentucky or West Virginia. They're doing their own thing and proud of it. Last slide before we come back and see where Julia is. I just thought this was really interesting. I pulled together, so we debuted, Julia, Bridget, Adam, and I were there back in 2001. And you see the episodes from 2001, tomato sauces for pasta, the perfect roast turkey, beef stew, perfect pork, how to cook salmon, stir fry made easy. And people are always asking me, what's changed in 20 years? And probably the number one thing that has changed has been the food. And you look at season 20, the season that's currently airing now, and these episodes are very different. It's much more global, more emphasis on healthy cooking, more sort of sciencey stuff, sous vide. It's just really evolved. And so I love those recipes from season one, a lot that I make. Season 20 is really much more contemporary. The way we eat and the way we cook has really changed in the 20 years we've been doing the show, and the show continues to reflect those changes. So there's a little snapshot of some numbers behind the scenes at America's Test Kitchen.
That's Jack. Fascinating, Jack, that you don't make rolls for Thanksgiving. I actually don't serve rolls.
I agree. We don't need
either.
Them.
Yeah. Yeah.
All the other starches, although, and this is a question we'll probably come back to later on because we have to talk about dessert, but pie. So there was no sweet potato pie on that list. Now, I'm from Mississippi and I am firmly in the sweet potato pie camp. Pumpkin pie is fine. I know it's the fall and all, but so maybe it's just me, all of you participating. I expect to see some fellow sweet potato pie fans in the chat shortly. If not, the cheese stands alone. Okay. So we have a winner and I'm trying to figure out, I'm checking my script, everybody. I'm not just winging it all. So I'm going to tell you the winner of the last one first, and then we're going to ask another giveaway question. And then we'll get to that winner later on as well. Does that make sense? You guys feel good about that? Nodding heads. Awesome. All right. So congratulations goes to, I just had it right here, Chris M. in Warrenville. We'll be in touch with you about your prizes. I actually think that somebody already has. So this is the new Zoom applause. I don't know if the rest of you have learned this as well, but congrats to Chris M. of Warrenville. And there may be some families of foodies who are joining us today. One winner per household, people. So if you get a lovely cookbook, then share. sharing is caring. And I should also mention in this apron, this one is signed by Jack, but you might be lucky enough to have one that is signed by Julia instead. So you'll get one or the other. And before we get to some questions, because our viewers have, our viewers, participants, I don't know what to call them right now because we're not on television. They've got questions, but there's another opportunity to win. And that, in order to win, you have to answer this question in the chat as well. First person to do it, to get it correct, with the hashtag HolidayTipsWTTW wins. And the question is, which ATK cast member appeared in the most viral social media post of ATK? I will repeat the question because I'm good at this. Which ATK cast member appeared in the most viral social media post of ATK? All right, and I see they're rolling in right now in the chat. All right, I will announce that winner later on. Julia, I think you have to finish cooking.
Yeah, so yeah. By the magic of television, I have the turkey already done, and you can see the stuffing here in the pan. You take the turkey out, you let it rest for about 20 minutes while the stuffing goes back in. I'm going to show you really quickly how easy it is to carve. I already carved half of it. So there's a bone that runs right through the center of this breast. It's very thin. And so what you want to do is you find the bone, and then you slice down on the side of it. And this is where you can use your hands and you can pull it open a bit. You can see where the bone is. And I'm actually going to turn this around so that the knife is on the right-hand side. And if it's hot, don't hesitate to grab a towel and hold the turkey, hot turkey, with the towel. And then just slowly using a sharp knife, peel away and cut away the turkey from the breast. And save this. This is magic. This with an onion and a carrot and a little celery in a pot, and you have the best broth to use up for your soup or your leftover. Leftovers in my house with turkey have to be turkey and dumplings, and I always save that. So I make the sauce because my daughter is in love with dumplings now. So,
although a viewer made the point that the rolls that none of us is having are good for leftovers, future turkey sandwich people.
Well, I don't think Jack would appreciate my favorite sandwich, which has stuffing on it. It's bread stuffing on the sandwich.
The stuffing sandwich. Good.
Oh, with the turkey and the cranberry. Okay.
Can I just say that roasting pan looks so good, Julia. It's like, and she's doing all the cooking, cleaning, and the food styling. I mean, you know, oh my heavens.
Multi-talented.
Thanks, Jack. Yeah, well, you know what? This recipe is really easy to make look good because it happens all by itself in the oven. So then now that this turkey breast is boneless, you can just go through and slice it up.
And what if I'm a dark meat fan? I know, I don't say it to be cancerous, mm-hmm. I promise.
No, I hear you. I'm also a dark meat fan. Yeah. you can. Do you like the drumsticks? They're my favorite.
Yeah, I love a thigh.
Oh, yeah, the thighs are good. You could easily put those parts on here. Now, remember the magic number for white meat is 160, 165. Dark meat's different. You want to cook dark meat to a higher temperature to help break down more of that collagen and cook it through. Dark meat is 175, and that's both for turkey and chicken. So again, knowing those temperatures, there's just a few to know, and having a good InstaRead thermometer will really catapult your cooking to the next level. So here, I'm just picking up all this sliced meat, and I'm gonna put it right on top of, oops, a little messy, right on top of the stuffing. And then I'm going to make a quick sauce. Now, gravy is the preferred side dish in this house for us and the dogs. And I always make make-ahead gravy. It is one of the best recipes. We have it on our website. You, well ahead of time, make the broth, you can freeze it, and then you can whip up a huge batch of gravy, like more gravy than you'll ever need, which is my preferred amount, yield for gravy, a big old pot.
A bunch of gravy, that's a gallon of gravy.
So you could do that with this recipe, but I'm gonna show you another quick recipe here. I'm gonna put this camera down again for a vinaigrette. Or a sauce, and we're going to use parsley. Now, this is Italian leaf parsley, and you want to chop about 3/4 cup. You know, a question we get a lot, and Jack, you can answer this because you're the tasting guy, but the difference between Italian leaf and curly leaf, and you can talk about that while I chop up this parsley.
Yeah, we really prefer the flat leaf or the Italian parsley. It has a better flavor. You know, I'm not going to say you can't use the curly stuff, but it's not as soft. It's not, I feel like it's a little on the bitter side. So, you know, it looks pretty, but we don't really use it in test kitchen. We really much prefer the flat leaf or the Italian style parsley. It just tastes better. It's softer and I don't know. It's the preferred parsley. How does that sound?
Yeah. Yep. And when chopping parsley, you really just want to use the leaves. Save the stems, though. You can freeze the stems and throw them into your soups or your stocks just to add a little bit of flavor. Also, I discovered this. It's our winning mini salad spinner, which is perfect for herbs. I bought this for doing the show at home, and I never had a mini one. It is a game changer. I use it more than the big one now. So this is a fun present.
And Julie, we're talking about tools. Your chopping board, your cutting board, someone has asked, they're having a hard time finding a big one. How big is yours?
Oh, let's see. Look, I have my ruler.
I know. I have a ruler right here.
I do. I'm from America's Test Kitchen. Of course I have a ruler in my truck. All right, so let's see. This one is nice and big. This is, let's see, that's 12 and 6. So that's 18 by...
Wow.
18 by 24.
I want to see you lift it, Julia. Come on. Let's. How heavy is that board? Okay. All right.
That is a big board.
It is a big board. But they make thicker ones that I don't like because I'm short. And the thicker one really makes the counter too tall for me. So I'm chopping up here. Small cutting boards are my biggest pet peeve in the kitchen. I like to have a lot of space because I like to have the raw ingredients on one side to be prepped and the prepped ingredients on the other side so that I can be efficient. You can pull the raw ingredients over, chop it, and then push it to the other side. So here I have this bowl with all the parsley. To this, we're gonna add 3/4 cup of pomegranate seeds, which, you know, now used to have to, you know, get them out of the fruit on your own, which is best done in a bowl of water because all the little white fluffy membrane bits float. But now you can buy them already done, which is amazing. Some shallot, a little bit of salt, some good olive oil. It's about 1/2 cup. And there's another trick, and this is a trick that Bridget taught me. And I love pre-peeled garlic, you know, buying them in these bags and throwing them in the freezer. And then when you want minced garlic, you pull one out and you do it on your rasp grater. And it's really easy. The garlic gets nice and fine. And the garlic doesn't get away from you in those bags. Because sometimes it's hard to use up that much.
In the freezer.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I mean, obviously.
Yeah, prep it up. So you can just take a peeled garlic. Whoops. And just really quickly mince it right on the microplane. And, you know, we did a testing of these rasp graters because this winner is by microplane. I think I mentioned that. And they had the copyright on this product for a while. And but their copyright's up. And now a lot of different companies are making them. But microplane is still our favorite by far because the teeth have the right level of pitch to get just the zest, but not enough of the pith. They're angled just right in rows. The handle's comfortable. And during the testing, when we test equipment, we have all sorts of people do the testing. Big hands, little hands, experienced cooks, newbie cooks, tall, short, you name it. They would use this and then they would wash it 20 times through a dishwasher for abuse and then plunge it in and out of a crowded crock of utensils 20 times, use it, wash it, and do that crock test to see which one will last. And this one really does hold up. So microplane is still the one to get. Last but not least, some lemon juice using our favorite juicer. Jack, you have one of these juicers, don't you? They really do get more juice out than the old-fashioned ones with this sort of double hinge. Yeah. And I know this one's green, which would denote that you're supposed to use limes with it, but I find that it also works with lemons. So you want about 2 tablespoons of lemon juice in the sauce. And then it's just a nice variation, the gravy. And here I'm gonna go over and put it right on top of the turkey. I know we only have about a little more than 10 minutes left. If you want to start asking some of the Q&A questions, feel free. Well,
while you're on that one, you know, I'm curious, what are the cranberry implications if you were putting pomegranate on the turkey and dressing?
Oh, well, always cranberry sauce, always cranberry sauce. I always make it, but my husband and my daughter love the canned stuff. Absolutely love it. I hate it. I can't stand that canned stuff. They love it. And every year there is my husband sends a good hour trying to get the canned stuff out of the can without ruining any of the canned ridges. So it has the shape of the can while standing up on the plate. Gives him something to do.
But isn't there a hack for that? Like you put it in the freezer or something? I forget what. And then you let it go.
I don't know.
Out
He's so
way.
Happy when he does it. I don't want to bother him.
Something I learned as a kid. All right. So some of the questions. I've got a ton of questions, and I know our viewers do. One in particular, I think, that came up repeatedly that I'm not seeing now was about gluten-free. You know, is there a gluten-free bread that you like for traditional stuffing? I think the gluten-free question kind of came up a lot. Thoughts?
Yeah, the old winner, right, Jack, and you're the tasting guru, so you would remember. The old winner that is still a standard is Udi's, which you find in the frozen section, and it makes decent stuffing. Is there a new one on the market that you know of that we like, Jack?
I think that's still the best choice, and I think the most important thing is to, you know, dry it out. I mean, because the gluten-free breads tend to be kind of soft. I don't want to use the word mushy, but, you know, cut them into cubes, put them on a baking sheet and put them in the oven, like at 225 degrees before you use them for stuffing so that they really can soak up all that goodness. And, you know, any gluten-free bread that you like for sandwich is going to be, basically any bread you like for sandwich is going to be good, including cornbread for stuffing.
Okay. And then, you know, one of the questions I had, obviously you guys are doing ATK at home. And when we're watching, you know, the previous seasons, you've got that gigantic kitchen and you've got tons of people in it and, you know, testing things out. And how did that, you know, obviously you don't have access to that in this previous season. So how did that affect, you know, the recipes that you chose? How are you still able to test things? Like, it sounds like for a taste test, you send things around, like products to fellow cast members and everybody weighs in on a Zoom call, or how does that work?
Yeah, for recipe selection for this season, we definitely chose easier recipes. So the turkey I just showed, for example, I had the turkey that and the stuffing that have already been roasted. We call that a twin. And when we're in the studio, we do twins for anything that takes more than say 8 to 10 minutes. So sauteed onions, even if cutting up all the bread for the stuffing, for example, we probably would have shown a minute or two of that. And then they would have brought in a bowl of already prepped bread. And that's just because we have a lot of people, a lot of cameras, a lot of camera people, everyone in the control room. And that's just a lot of people standing around watching someone cook. So we try to speed it up to be as efficient as possible and film as much as we can in a day. Right, that wasn't the case at home. I did all my own twins. I tried to pick recipes without many twins. I had in my little pod of people, my good friend lives down the street. She was my roommate in culinary school, and she came over and helped me. I set up a little prep kitchen in my living room with racks and a table. And luckily it was in the summer, and I got my husband and my dogs and my daughter to go camping for 2 weeks, basically, so that I could film the show, because I obviously were taking over my kitchen for 2 weeks. I couldn't easily make breakfast or dinner. So, yeah, but that was it. And we also just slowed down. Instead of trying to film 4 or 5 recipes a day, which is usual for us, we would do 2. And so it was just a much more relaxed pace, which I think will show in the final edits of season 20 of this next season, 2021, just that we're at home, we're a bit more relaxed, and we're showing food, you know, cooked in our home kitchens that's just a little on the easier side. And as I said earlier, we really focused on getting back to basics, because I think we're going to have a lot of new viewers this year, and we have a lot of new people logging onto our website because people want to know how to cook.
And the recipe development has been going on at home. So our kitchen operations team, which is the folks you usually see in the background on our show, they spent the last 8 months figuring out how to get, on average, groceries delivered to 30 different homes every week so that recipe testing could happen. And my favorite recipe testing is some of the folks have been making the same recipe at the same time and then getting on Zoom and tasting it together. In terms of a recipe that was in development, and it's actually, I think, one of the things that I've heard from everyone who develops recipes is it's given us an appreciation for recipes that minimize the number of pots and pans and bowls and spoons and food processors that are dirty, because of course, you know, everybody who's been doing the cooking is also doing all the washing all day, and very, very aware of that.
A question from someone in the chat right now. Super important, 2 things. One, that dish looks delicious. I want to just point that out, and I hope everybody who's at home watching is applauding.
See if you can see.
Yeah, we could see it on the, I don't know what to call the turkey cam.
The stove cam.
It's super important to know who's going to eat all that.
My family is so excited to have a turkey for a few days. They've lined up what they want me to make. We're making a turkey curry, turkey and dumplings. There's a couple turkey sandwiches slated. So, and the dogs, they'll probably get a little turkey too, because we like to share with them.
It's kind of like in Forrest Gump with the shrimp soup.
Turkey sandwich,
turkey stuffing.
But, you know, and for the folks at home who, the test cooks who are cooking, right. We usually we don't donate food from the test kitchen because it's half eaten and half, you know, poked at. But we have something called the take home fridge where all the leftovers go, and everyone from the company in the office can go in there and get lunch or get something for takeout. But we don't have that. So all the test cooks have, you know, loads of food at their house. And so everyone's pods now includes the neighbors, and the neighbors are all getting really well fed around all the test cooks in all those neighborhoods.
Where do you guys live? I'm going to move. Just, you know, rent a room from one of your neighbors. another question from that was sent in advance. And then I want to, in a little bit, I want to announce the winner from the last giveaway, because I haven't done that yet. To brine or not to brine the turkey?
I'm Camp Brine. What about you, Julia?
I salt overnight. Okay. Or sometimes I don't do either. And I make gallons of gravy.
You're still serving gravy, like, you know, will, even despite if there's no turkey. The sauce that is already on this turkey.
Yeah. You know, I really like the crisp skin. And so I like the salting because I feel like it gets that skin really crisp. Now, do you air dry after you brine, Jack?
Yeah, so I brine on Wednesday, Use a cooler with a lot of ice. Then I gotta wash the cooler, and that's a project, but that's something I look forward to. And then I air dry it overnight. So I usually brine it during the day on Wednesday for about 8 hours, and then put it on a rack inside a baking sheet and throw it in an, you need to have an extra fridge, because there's not gonna be room. If you only have, I've got an extra fridge in the basement, and let it air dry. And I find that, I don't do a good enough job on the salting, and I end up with some salty patches, and that the brine, you get more even seasoning, although the skin is not as crispy. I mean, if you really like crispy skin, you should be salting rather than brining.
One more quick question, because I think we're getting a little tight on time, but so one of the things, Jack, you mentioned this in your presentation, and I noticed it a little bit in my research, there have been some changes for you guys. You've got obviously the new editor at Cook's Country, and El Simone's her podcast that she's recently started. What can you tell us about some of those changes?
Yeah, we continue to build better what we're doing. And so Tony Tipton Martin, who is an award-winning journalist, scholar, cook, if you don't know her by her books, you should go out and buy them. She's won 2 James Beard Awards, which are basically like the Emmys for cookbook authors, for her last 2 books. She's joining us in a week from Monday as the new editor-in-chief of our Cook's Country brand, and super excited for her to join the team. And you know, our colleague Elle, we love her. If you watch ATK, I think she has the most fun, and I love that both Elle and Aaron got their moms on season 21. I'm a little worried that my mother's gonna be really upset, Julia, that like—
Ditto.
Tell your mom to turn off the television.
Jack. You made it a step worse.
Yeah, I don't know what I'm going to do, but our friend Elle, she's launched a new podcast. We now have 3 podcasts, but Elle's new podcast is called The Walk-In. And it's a great interview style, talking to people who are just absolutely fascinating, telling stories you haven't heard anywhere else about, working in the food business and telling underrepresented stories from communities and people that we don't hear from. And her podcast, if you are not listening to The Walk-In, you should go wherever you listen to podcasts, Stitcher, iTunes, and subscribe.
I was told that we have time for a few extra questions, which I think everybody will be excited about. And these are also from people who sent them in advance. Sarah asks, what is the best way to make mashed potatoes, and how do you keep them fresh until serving time? In your presentation, Jack, you did mention a mashed potato casserole dish.
Yeah, so basically I make this every year. You make the mashed potatoes the way you normally would, but then you, instead of ricing the potatoes, you throw them into a mixer. With a lot of eggs, along with a little bit of mustard and broth, and you're basically enriching them, and then you put them into a casserole dish. And so you can do this 1 or 2 days before you want to bake them. And then you sort of do something decorative with the top, and then they go into the oven when the turkey comes out. So they basically need 30 to 40 minutes in the oven, and they kind of souffle and get crispy and brown on top. And, you know, if you're going to have, I had 18 people last year, I'm not making mashed potatoes to order for 18 people. That's just way crazy. And so, but I'm perfectly willing to make mashed potatoes on Wednesday for people to come on Thanksgiving and enjoy. And so it's a great way to make mashed potatoes for a crowd, because it reduces the stress. And I just love that all those eggs, oh, it's just, they're delicious.
Another question, where did it go? I saw it a second ago, but there've been, I think, a couple of questions basically about what kind of sides do you recommend making in advance? And then maybe freezing them if possible, thoughts.
Yeah. I saw a question earlier on that was about making a vegetable side for a large crowd. It looked like 25 people. Mm-hmm. There's one recipe that I get requested to make every year, and it is the easiest recipe. You can make it a day ahead. It's called Caesar green beans. It doesn't sound like much of a recipe, but I tell you what, they blow the roof off the house every time I make them. You blanch the beans in salted water, and then you spread them out on a cookie sheet that's lined with a towel, and you just let them hang out. And you can do it a day ahead and put them in the fridge. And then the Caesar style dressing is delicious with the other flavors like cranberry and gravy on the plate. And it's a little bright and fresh. There's no raw egg in that one. And you make croutons, and you can make a huge platter of these things, and they can sit out for hours and they're just fine. And like I said, yeah, that's probably, and actually I make them all year long for parties, for big crowds because they're such a winner.
I love that. Okay. Oh, I like this question. What are your top one or two can't live without small kitchen appliances?
Ooh. Well, let me take a look around. Okay, yep, got one. This is electric tea kettle. It is their winning one by OXO. We use this all day long. My husband loves tea. I use it for coffee and a French press. When a recipe is on the stove and it looks like getting a little burnt in one corner, I grab this and I pour a little water into that corner of the pan to prevent it from burning. If a recipe calls for boiling water, this is what I use. So I'd say electric tea kettle is up there for me. Tongs.
I have four. These are non-stick because they've got the silicone tips. So I have two of these and two regular ones. You know, they're more hands. And I use them to turn things, to stir things, to lift things, to move things. Tongs. And you can never
get things off the top shelf of the cupboard.
I do that.
I have a pair of long tongs just for that. These are, yeah.
Oh, those are big.
Long just for tongs the top shelf. Yeah, just because I can't get up there. It's just hard.
I do it too. Don't tell my husband. I'm going to take this one. This question straight from the chat will be our last one. What is your favorite thing you have to have at Thanksgiving?
Ooh, well, Jack, you have 16 plush dishes. Do you have a favorite?
You know what? The thing that I have gotten the most attached to, I'm just an ornery person here, so I'm just going to go out there, is my Brussels sprouts salad from Cook's Country. I mean, so for years, I'm like, my wife's aunt is the only person who eats Brussels sprouts for years. And for years, I would make old-fashioned Brussels sprouts, and I would braise them or roast them, and it would be just the two of us. I mean, everyone else was like, these are disgusting. We don't want to touch them. And then about 4 years ago, I switched, and I made this recipe, and I love it because it's a make-ahead recipe because it's a salad. It's fresh. You shred them really fine with a sharp knife. You can use a food processor, and it's a mustardy vinaigrette. And now everyone loves Brussels sprouts. I mean, think about it. It's basically cabbage. It's like coleslaw, but for Thanksgiving with a mustard vinaigrette. And it's like, and it's great on sandwiches. When you do that stuffing sandwich to put some Brussels sprouts with the cranberry sauce and the turkey for leftovers, it's my favorite thing every year for Thanksgiving.
Julia, how about yours?
We have a weird thing in our family. It's curried creamed onions. I have no idea. I grew up with these things. So they're the little white onions. And you cook them and you make like a bechamel, but you make it with yellow curry powder. So it's really curried. And I have no idea. Since I was a kid, I've loved these things. And the flavor of the curried cream sauce with the cranberry sauce is perfection.
I want to know more about that, but we have to go. That sounds great. So thank you so much. Don't go anywhere yet, obviously, because a couple of things. I want to announce the winner of our last giveaway, and there will be more, everybody, so don't panic. Helen S. in Highland Park, congratulations to you for winning a WTTW Cook's apron and the America's Test Kitchen 20th Anniversary Cookbook, which kind of matches my shirt, which is super important. I also want to remind everybody that the this recipe, you will be receiving it by email. So don't sweat if you didn't get it down. Don't worry about it. This has been a ton of fun and a treat for me to be able to join the two of you. So thank you so much. Before we go, I do want to give a few more people, though, as I mentioned, a chance to win an autographed WTTW Cook's Apron by Julia or Jack, and of course, the aforementioned cookbook, as well as the complete Cook's Country Season 13 TV show cookbook. Here goes. The first three people to post their favorite tip from today on WTTW's Facebook page before tomorrow at 5:00, this is my stress ball, ignore that, will win. It's just a fidget. You guys can't see what I can see. those folks will win those amazing prizes. And don't forget to use the hashtag HolidayTipsWTTW. So I'm going to repeat it. The first three people to post their favorite tip from today on WTTW's Facebook page before tomorrow at 5, using the hashtag HolidayTipsWTTW. Thank you again to Julia and Jack for spending time with us and sharing these awesome tips, as well as offering the insights into cooking this holiday season. And to Julia for doing the cooking. I'm sure all of your holiday meals will be better for it. And also thanks to our members, for all of you, for joining us this afternoon and supporting as always. Be sure to keep watching America's Test Kitchen at 2 p.m. and 2:30 on Saturdays. The new season of Cook's Country is on at noon. And of course, season 21 of ATK starts in January. Keep an eye out for the specific date. Of course, you can join me on Chicago Tonight weeknights at 7 p.m., as well as Chicago Tonight Black Voices on Sunday night at 6 p.m., streaming anytime at WTTW.com/news. Of course, you can also catch us on our Facebook and YouTube channels. Thank you so much for attending, and happy cooking, Julia and Jack. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Brandis. So nice to see you.
Likewise.
Yeah, thank you so much, and we really support you know, thank you for your support and, you know, wishing everybody a safe, happy holiday season.
Absolutely. Thanks, everybody. Bye.